Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Abhinav and I hope you're all doing fine and preparations for UPSC CMS exams on full swing, I guess. So what we'll do today is we'll do an important activity that is need to be done by every student before attending the exam. So what we'll do is we'll solve the UPSC CMS last year's question paper, that is we'll solve paper one together. Okay, so we'll be solving this together. And in between, I will also give some small explanations for the questions. Okay, so without wasting time, let's start solving the questions. So the first question is, a chronic alcoholic develops a paroxysm of palpitations after alcohol binge. Which of the following arrhythmias is most likely? So if you see alcohol patients, the commonest arrhythmia is noted to be atrial fibrillation. Now in this patient, there is also paroxysms of palpitations, so which is usually seen in atrial fibrillation. Okay. So the next question: an elderly man with a history of diabetes, CAD, complains of muscle pains. So which of the drugs could have caused it? So aspirin, glimepiride, enalapril, atorvastatin. We all know that statins are notable to cause myalgias. So the common side effects of statins is myalgias, and in this patients, the complaints of muscle pain, the drug usually it is atorvastatin. So a 40-year-old lady comes to outdoor clinic with complaints of sudden onset chest pain. So sudden, the chest X-ray shows bilateral pneumothorax. Examination reveals abnormalities of body habitus, including long arms, legs, and fingers. So long arms, long legs, and long fingers, and pneumothorax. We all know that it's commonly seen in Marfan syndrome. So this patient's also having scoliosis, high arched palate, joint hypermobility, pansystolic murmur. So the examiner wants to help us by giving all these clues. So pansystolic murmur at the cardiac apex, which is the following disease likely? It's Marfan syndrome. So the next question. All of the following are indications of treadmill testing and exercise testing, except. So we usually do this to confirm the diagnosis of angina. Okay, so they have given only angina. In unstable angina, it's not recommended, but in stable angina, we can do. So since they have given only angina, this option can be true. And to evaluate stable angina, yes. To assess the outcome after coronary revascularization, yes. To evaluate the treatment efficacy of anti-angina drugs. Now, commonly the treatment efficacy, it's not evaluated by treadmill testing at all. So that will be the exception. Kussmaul's sign is present in all of the following conditions, except Kussmaul's sign is with inspiration, there is JVP rise. So it is usually seen when there is the heart, there is overload of the heart and there is back pressure coming to the JVPs. So in massive pulmonary embolism, yes. So there can be back pressure to the JVPs directly. Restrictive cardiomyopathy, yes, because the cardiac output is not good. And hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, I don't think so. Because in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, usually the cardiac output is good. So there is no back pressure causing Kussmaul's sign. So this should be the answer. And right ventricular infarction, yes, there can be Kussmaul's sign. So the answer is HOCM. Which of the following is not a common cause of atrial fibrillation? So atrial fibrillation usually in mitral regurgitation, yes. Hypothyroidism, not really. Hypertension, yes. Acute MI, yes. So atrial fibrillation is, so logically seeing fibrillation means there is, the heart rate is increased. So in hypothyroidism, usually there can be heart block. So that is bradyarrhythmias instead of tachyarrhythmias like atrial fibrillation. So the option should be hypothyroidism. In an ECG recording, P wave is produced by atrial depolarization. Easy question. Which of the following modalities is not used in the treatment of ventricular tachycardia? Okay, DC cardioversion, obviously we do that. Lignocaine, no. Amiodarone, yes. Amiodarone is like a... Just like how we have broad spectrum antibiotics, amiodarone is like a broad spectrum antiarrhythmic. So it has many mechanism of action. So usually this is a good choice to be noted. So this will be given. Injection lignocaine, yes, it can be given in ventricular arrhythmias, but injection adenosine, it is given in supraventricular arrhythmias, but in ventricular tachycardia, it's not given. Which of the following drugs is a direct renin inhibitor? EC, aliskiren. Which of the following are causes of systolic hypertension with wide pulse pressure? Except. So, systolic hypertension with wide pulse pressure. Pulse pressure is basically systolic minus diastolic. So, with systolic hypertension, for us to have a wide pulse pressure, the diastolic blood pressure should be really low. So, which of the causes which can cause this? Except. Okay. So, except is the one thing that will have high diastolic blood pressure. So, there won't be wide pulse pressure. So, that should be the option. In aortic regurgitation, yes. Thyrotoxicosis, yes. PDA, yes. Aortic stenosis, no. So, if you see in the aortic stenosis, the systolic hyper, so there is the systolic blood pressure is high, but at the same time, the diastolic blood pressure is also high. So, there is a narrow pulse pressure instead of a wide pulse pressure. So, wide pulse pressure will be seen when the diastolic blood pressure is low. So, in aortic regurgitation, thyrotoxicosis, PDA, the diastolic blood pressure can be low, causing a wide pulse pressure. Signet ring sign on CT chest is bronchiectasis. Oral corticosteroids are best introduced in the treatment of chronic bronchial asthma when it is. So, we'll start with the inhaled corticosteroids, but we usually do not give oral corticosteroids in asthma patient unless or until it is very severe. So it's very severe and persistent bronchial asthma. That is when we give oral corticosteroids. An 18-year-old male has insulin-dependent diabetes with malabsorption syndrome and bilateral upper lobe bronchiectasis. A diagnostic workup will include all except. So malabsorption syndrome, so we'll do 24 hours fecal fat estimation. So, upper lobe bronchiectasis, CT chest to be done. Lung biopsy, there is no need, there is no indication actually for lung biopsy, so this should be the answer. Since this patient has some kind of syndromic association, diabetes, malabsorption, bronchiectasis, so a DNA sequencing study should be done. So, the one thing that is not necessary is lung biopsy. Which of the following antigens is commonly associated with causation of farmer's lung? So, farmer's lung is actinomyces or aspergillus. It's actinomycetes. That is thermophilic actinomycetes usually causing farmer's lung, but aspergillus is usually causing malt lung. The gene expert used in MTBE detection, gene expert that is CBNAT, there is additional advantage of detection of which of the following? So, gene expert can diagnose the tuberculosis as well as can give rifampicin resistance. Most common cause of chronic type 2 respiratory failure. So type 2 respiratory failure is usually ventilation defect. Type 1 is oxygenation defect. So in type 2 respiratory failure, the most common cause is severe COPD. So asthma going into respiratory failure, type 2 respiratory failure is has less chance as compared to COPD. Most frequent symptom in respiratory diseases? No. I've seen this question. The question is actually wrong. There is no nothing like most frequent symptom in respiratory distress. Okay. So a 26-year-old young lady attends medical emergency and is labeled as acute severe asthma by the emergency physician. Which of the following is unlikely to be a part of the prescription? So what we all know the treatment protocol for acute severe asthma. We'll start with albuterol and then we can also give aminophylline and finally we'll also give magnesium sulfate, that is 2 grams. So the one thing that is not commonly used is antileukotrienes. So because in acute severe the antileukotrienes are not very effective and they are slow as well. Which of the following statement with regard to respiratory examination are correct? So change in note when the patient phonates EEE is characteristic of interstitial fibrosis, no. Whispered pectrolochy's characteristics of lung consolidation, yes. Monophonic wheeze is character of asthma, no. It's polyphonic wheeze. Hyperresonant in percussion is characteristic of pneumothorax. Yes, pneumothorax means basically air inside a cavity, just like a drum. If you would have seen a drum, there is just air inside, but when you beat the drum, it's the sound is really heavy. So that's hyperresonant sound. Same principle applies to the pneumothorax as well. So the answer is 2 and 4. Whispered pectrolochy and hyperresonant are correct. All of the following are causes of exudative pleural effusion, except. So exudative pleural effusion is something that just remember like this. Exudative means the fluid is exiting out via a break or a gate. Okay. Transudative is the fluid is just transferring out without a break in the blood capillaries. Okay. So exudate means there is a break in blood capillary and the fluid exits out. Transudate means there is no break, the fluid just transfers out. Okay. So what can cause a break in the capillaries, which leads to exudative pleural effusion? So SVC obstruction, no, there's just obstruction. Infection can cause a break. SLE, the antigen-antibody complex, can cause a break. Meigs syndrome is usually something related to cancer, so it can also cause a break. So SVC is obstruction. So when there is obstruction, there is fluid buildup. So what will the pressure changes and the fluid just transfers out. So when it is transferring out, that is transudative pleural effusion. So the answer here is SVC obstruction. Which one of the following is not true about ghrelin? What is ghrelin? Ghrelin is just an hormone which stimulates your appetite. Okay, so the opposite of ghrelin is leptin. So leptin that makes our stomach feels satiety. Okay, so ghrelin is a hormone that makes you feel hungry. So what can make you feel hungry? If your appetite is stimulated, that can make you feel hungry. If your gastric emptying is decreased, no, it will not make you hungry. Your gastric emptying is increased and you have more space in the stomach, then you will feel hungry. So this is the wrong answer. Ghrelin increases acid secretion, yes. Fasting increases its secretion, yes. When you are fasting, you obviously feel hungry because of ghrelin. Fecal elastase test, diagnosing which of the following? Elastase is usually pancreatic dysfunction. A recent classification system for listing a patient as a candidate for liver transplantation. So for liver transplantation, recent classification system, no, child puke is not recent. And it also says if there is a need for transplant or not. But listing a patient as a candidate for liver transplant, usually it's a MELD score, model for end-stage liver disease score. Apache score is a scoring system for the grading of pancreas and metaverse score also. The blood supply of liver is usually 80% portal vein and 20% hepatic artery. Which of the following conditions are associated with glomerulonephritis with low complement level? Except. Okay, subacute bacterial endocarditis, yes. And it is usually antigen-antibody complex depositing in the heart. IgA nephropathy, no. It's just the IgA, not antigen-antibody complex. SLE, yes, the antigen-antibody complex forms, so the complement level decreases. Cryoglobulinemia is, yes, going into cold causing thrombosis. So the next question is, consider the following statements with regard to oral abscess ulcer. Okay, they are superficial and painful. Obviously, they may occur in women just prior to menstruation. Yes, oral glucocorticoids may be needed for treatment of severe and recurrent cases. Yes, they are pre-malignant and progress over a few years to squamous cell carcinoma. No. Usually, Majolin's ulcer is usually progressing and becoming a squamous cell carcinoma. So oral ulcers don't do that. So the answer is 1, 2. So the following statements regarding Barrett's esophagus is not correct. So it's a pre-malignant condition. Yes, normal squamous cell lining the lower esophagus are replaced by columnar cells. Yes, normal columnar cells replace. No. No, option C is wrong. It's an adaptive response to chronic GERD. So, not true is normal columnar cells lining the lower esophagus are replaced by squamous cells. No, it's just the opposite thing. So, the most common cause of acute hepatitis outbreaks in India is hepatitis A. Spontaneous esophageal perforation after a bout of forceful vomiting. You must know the diagnosis. Or retching is correctly seen in which of the following? Boerhaave syndrome. So, eradication of H. pylori infection may prove beneficial in the following extragastric disorders. Except. So, eradication of H. pylori is beneficial in which disorders? Except. So, unexplained vitamin B12 deficiency? Yes. ITP? Yes. Iron deficiency anemia? Yes. Acute glomerulonephritis? No. I think it's not associated with H. pylori. So this should be the answer. What is the target blood hemoglobin level when treating anemia stage 4 chronic kidney disease? So target hemoglobin in stage 4 is 10 to 12. Which of the following complications of CKD is observed in patients with low parathyroid hormone levels? Adynamic bone disease, tumor calcinosis, OFC, calciphylaxis. So tumor calcinosis is seen in hyperparathyroidism. Osteatosis fibrosis in hyperparathyroidism. Calciphylaxis also in hyperparathyroidism. So low parathyroid hormones is usually adynamic bone disease in CKD patients. All of the following statements about the adult polycystic kidney disease are true except. It is inherited autosomal dominant. Yes. Usually associated with marked proteinuria. I don't think so. Usually associated with systemic hypertension, yes. Associated with baryonyxia, yes. So the option, the answer should be associated with marked proteinuria. No, it is not associated with proteinuria. Consider the following statements in relation to an adult patient. Oliguria is defined as passage of urine less than 300. No, it's 400. Anuria is said to exist when less than 50 ml urine is passed per day. No, it's 100. Polyuria is defined as urine volume in excess of 3 liters. Yes. So answer 3 is true, which I don't have. So only option 3 is true. Only this is true. White cell casts in urine examination are strongly suggestive. White cell casts. White cell casts sounds like something infection, WBC. So usually it's seen in pyelonephritis. 13-year-old boy presents with hematuria, oliguria, edema, hypertension. History of sore throat last 2 weeks prior to presentation. Labs show low C3 complement levels and increased titers of ASO and anti-DNS. Which of the following statements is not correct about the management of this condition? So this patient is probably suffering from post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So renal biopsy is rarely required for making diagnosis true. Antibiotic treatment for streptococcal infection true. Treatment is largely supportive, yes. Immunosuppressants to be used for crescentic glomerulonephritis. No. Immunosuppressants are usually used in conditions like minimal sense disease. So rarely used in PSGN. So this should be the answer. Next question. Which of the following statement is not correct regarding the risk factors for nephrolithiasis? Higher dietary calcium increases risk. No, this is a false thing. Eating more calcium does not make you high risk for kidney stones. Higher animal protein, yes. Intake, yes. Higher dietary potassium intake lowers the risk, yes. Lower urine citrate increases the risk, yes. So answer is higher dietary calcium increases risk. No. 60-year-old patient is admitted in emergency with seizure, aphasia, altered sensory. He had history of fever, headache. For the preceding 3 days, CSF examination is unremarkable. What could be the probable diagnosis? Multiple sclerosis? No, it should be like more of a chronic thing. Tubercular meningitis can be, but in CSF examination, there would be lymphocytosis. In pyogenic bacterial meningitis, obviously, the CSF examination is going to be very bad. In viral encephalitis, yes, viral encephalitis can cause. It's like sterile encephalitis or aseptic encephalitis. So viral encephalitis usually causes fever and then seizures, but the CSF examination can be normal. Drug of choice for the treatment of trigeminal neuralgia, carbamazepine, yes. If you give aciclofenac, it's not even going to test the pain of the patient. The pain is really bad in trigeminal neuralgia. Thiamine can be given, but not a drug of choice. Prednisone can be given, but not again the drug of choice. Drug of choice is carbamazepine. Construction skills is a function of which lobe? So dominant temporal lobe, frontal lobe, parietal lobe. Frontal lobe is usually behavior, thinking, behavior actually. Frontal lobe behavior. And temporal lobe is usually like hearing, listening, hearing processing. Parietal lobe is usually construction skills. The complex skills are usually seen in the parietal lobe. So the answer should be non-dominant parietal lobe. Vertical gaze palsy with convergent retraction nystagmus. Convergent retraction nystagmus, it's a catchphrase for the answer, Parinaud syndrome. So a patient on looking forward was found to have right eye deviated downwards and outwards. So downward and outwards is usually third nerve palsy. So in his right eye, so it's right third nerve palsy. All of the following are features of cauda equina syndrome. Cauda equina is at the lower level of spinal cord ending. So it causes lower back pain, yes. Lower limb areflexia, yes. Loss of bladder control, yes. Extensor plantar response, no. So cauda equina is usually at the end of the spinal cord. There can be some tumor compressing the spinal cord, causing all these symptoms. So it's usually the extensor plantar response is not seen. A 68-year-old man presented to the OPD with complaints of progressive small handwriting. On examination, has resting tremors, bradykinesia, rigidity, postural instability. And what more do you need to figure out the answer? It's Parkinson's disease. An elderly patient presents abnormal gait, has wide base freezing gait. So wide base freezing gait, imbalance, compressing short strides, shuffling along the floor, and difficulty with starts and turns. Heel shin test is normal, most likely it's all. Cerebral ataxia, no, because the heel shin test is normal. Sensory ataxia, the patient will, the gait will be like actually stomping the floor. So they do not feel this. Sollu Balu. Illaya Balu. So the next question. An elderly patient presents with abnormal gait. He has wide base freezing gait with imbalance, compressing short strides, shuffling along the floor, difficulty with starts and turns. Heel shin test is normal. Which of the following is most likely to solve? So cerebral ataxia, no, because heel shin test is normal. Sensory ataxia, the patient is not feeling where his legs is actually. So he will actually be stomping the floor. So that gait is different. Frontal gait disorder, yes, this could be the cause. Again, Parkinson's doesn't cause a wide base freezing gait. Cushing reflex seen in condition of raised intracranial pressure includes all of the following except bradycardia, yes. Hypertension, yes. Irregular respiration, yes. No hypothermia. 35-year-old man presents with history of low-grade fever, headache last 5 weeks. Clinical examination is remarkable for signs of meningitis. Undergoes lumbar puncture and a day later reports worsening of headache. So the following features is not consistent with diagnosis of post-lumbar puncture headache. The post-lumbar puncture headache usually begins within 48 hours, yes. Worsens in sitting position, yes. So most is severe upon waking up, no. It usually gets painful as the time passes by. So may improve with caffeine intake, yes. So the answer is most severe upon waking up this wrong. Which of the following investigations is not appropriate in a case of recurrent thrombosis? Recurrent thrombosis, so the cause may be either increased thrombotic things or decrease in antithrombotic things. So antiphospholipid antibody, yes, we should do that. BCR-ABL, no need, because usually it is seen in leukemias, CML. So protein C and SSA, yes, they are prothrombotics. Antithrombin level, yes, we have to check if it is low. All of the following are causes of reactive thrombocytosis, except hemolytic anemia, yes, megaloblastic anemia, yes, post-splenectomy, yes, chronic inflammatory disorders, yes. So usually reactive thrombocytosis is not seen in megaloblastic anemia. So please check with the answer. I'm not sure about it. So hemolytic anemia, yes. After splenectomy, yes, thrombocytosis will be there. After hemolysis, yes, there will be thrombocytosis. After a chronic inflammation, yes, there is going to be thrombocytosis. So in megaloblastic anemia, there will be reactive thrombocytosis. There will not be reactive thrombocytosis. So this is the answer. Cryoprecipitate cannot be used for treatment of each of the following conditions. So cryoprecipitate contains 1 Willebrand fractures, 1 Willebrand factor, fibrinogen factor 8 and factor 13. So hemophilia B is usually deficient of factor 9. So we cannot give cryoprecipitate in hemophilia B. Pyruvate kinase deficiency results in deficiency of ATP production and a chronic hemolytic anemia. The disorder is inherited. So usually this metabolic inherited disorder, pediatric syndromes, these are usually autosomal recessive. So only there are only a few exceptions you need to know. But pyruvate kinase deficiency is autosomal recessive trait. Sickle cell disease may be associated with any of the following, except acute chest syndrome, yes. Aplastic crisis, yes. Splenic sequestration crisis, yes. Pond syndrome. Sickle cell disease doesn't cause Pond syndrome. Fever with splenomegaly and lymphadenopathy can be seen in infectious mononucleosis, yes. Chronic leukemia, yes. Both, yes. Answer should be both. Yearly individual carriers have. Every individual carriers have 4 alpha gene alleles. Deletion of 3 alleles leads to development of hemoglobin H disease. Which of the following is not true regarding CML? It is a clonal malignancy of hematopoietic stems? Yes. Risk of developing CML is increased in monozygotic twins? No. The risk is not actually increased in monozygotic twins. CML is defined by presence of BCR-ABL, obviously. 10-year survival tyrosine kinase inhibitor is 85%. Okay. Diagnostic criteria for multiple myeloma includes all of the following. So increased malignant plasma cells in bone marrow, yes. Serum and urine M protein, yes. Skeletal lytic or blastic. So multiple myeloma is usually lytic lesion. So the answer should be 1, 2, 1, 3. The most predominant type of serum immunoglobulin involved in patients with plasma cell disorder is IgG. So usually plasma cell disorder is IgG. So now the next question is, which one of the following statements is not true regarding the thyroid function or disorder in pregnancy? Usually in pregnancy, there is an excess need for the thyroid hormones. So which is not true? That is their argument. So there's an increase in the metabolism of thyroxine by placenta, yes. Hyperemesis gravidarum may be associated with thyrotoxicosis in pregnancy, yes. Levothyroxine replacement therapy dose should be decreased by 30-50% yearly in the pregnancy. So there's increase in need of the thyroid hormone. So at that time, we are not going to reduce the thyroid supplements. So impaired cognitive impairment may be seen in the offspring of mother with subclinical hypothyroidism too. So which one of the following is not the criteria for diagnosis of diabetes mellitus? So when diagnosing the diabetes, either we can see if the patient is having symptoms, and then we can do a random plasma glucose. So if it is more than 200, then it's diagnostic diabetes. The HbA1c is more than 6.5, then yes, diagnosed. 2-hour plasma glucose more than 200, yes. And fasting plasma glucose more than 110, no. So 110 to 125 is impaired glucose tolerance, and more than 126 is diagnostic. So a young lady presents in outdoor clinic with complaints of menstrual irregularity, weight gain, hair loss, tiredness, and weakness. So this is something related to thyroid, probably hypothyroidism. So what will be the investigation of choice? So we'll definitely need TSH levels. So here is TSH. So in this patient, the TSH level would be a bit high, okay, and the T3, T4 level will be low. Consider the following statements about erectile dysfunction in diabetic males. It affects 60% of males. Okay, let's see. Its common cause is an underlying neurovascular pathology. Yes, may be aggravated by beta adrenergic agonists. No. So normally beta blockers or beta drugs, they cause some amount of erectile dysfunction, but that is not aggravating the dysfunction that is present in diabetes. So endocrine disorder like hyperprolactinemia, may cause this. So I think the option should be 2 and 4, because it's not that almost 60% of men get erectile dysfunction. So it should be less than that. So answer would be 2 and 4. All of the following can cause hyperprolactinemia, except craniopharyngioma, yes. Pituitary gland tumor, so it can cause hyperprolactinemia. Hyperthyroidism, no. Usually in hypothyroidism, there can be increased TRH, thyrotropin releasing hormone secretion, which can act on prolactin levels also. So hypothyroidism can cause hyperprolactinemia, but hyperthyroidism will not cause it. So stress can cause, yes, chronic renal failure, chronic liver failure, yes, hyperprolactinemia. All of the following can be seen in cases of thyrotoxicosis, yes. Thyrotoxicosis, atrial fibrillation, yes. Periodic paralysis, yes. Deafness, no. Osteoporosis, yes. Which one of the following hormones acts at receptor tyrosine kinase? Very easy. Insulin like growth factor receptor one. Consider the following disorders of constitutive multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2A. 2A primary hyperparathyroidism, yes, we can see. Pituitary tumors, no. Medullary carcinoma of thyroid, yes. Pheochromocytoma, yes. So we can see 1, 3, 4. Consider the following statements regarding Graves' ophthalmopathy. Proptosis is often asymmetric and can even appear to be unilateral, yes. It is a clinical diagnosis, yes. Worsening of symptoms upon glucocorticoid withdrawal is common, yes. Radiation therapy is very effective. Usually radiation therapy to eye is not preferred. So 1, 2, 3. All of the following are common etiologies of delirium, except. So hyperthyroidism, yes. Hypothyroidism, yes. Hyperparathyroidism, yes. Hypoparathyroidism, no. So hyperthyroidism, delirium, yeah. Makes sense. Hypothyroidism can cause. Hyperparathyroidism, yes. We have seen that due to the calcium and phosphate imbalance, but hypoparathyroidism, no. Key anthropometric measures important for evaluating degree of obesity. Weight, height, waist. Weight, height, hip. Mid thigh or chest should be between waist and hip. Usually we take weight, height and waist. Waist is which is around the umbilical line. Okay, hip is near the circumference of the gluteal region. What is the minimum BMI recommended for considering adjuvant pharmacological treatment in obesity and comorbidity? So if the patient is having comorbidity, we need to go at the level of 27. If there is no comorbidity, at 30 BMI 30, we can consider adjuvant pharmacological treatments. A young medical student while working HIV ward pricked accidentally by finger by a syringe needle, which was used to draw blood from a patient. So patient's infection status is not known. Which of the following therapeutic interventions is the best interest of the student? So we'll need to start post-exposure prophylaxis, which is the three-drug regimen, dolutegravir, tenofovir, and entamizumab, plus hepatitis B immunoglobulin. Because the chances of hepatitis B spreading by a needle stick injury is more than chances of HIV being spread through the needle stick injury. HIV, it's only 0.3%. Cryptococcal infection inhalation rate. Which one of the following is not appropriate treatment for echinococcus granulosis and hydatid disease? Albendazole, sure. Diethyl carbamazine, no. We use Dilantin furoate, but Gayathri carbamazine not yet. Pair technique, yes. You need to study about this in surgery also. Praziquantel, yes. So diethyl carbamazine is usually not yet. Which one of the following infection is not amenable to post-exposure prophylaxis with specific immunoglobulins? So what you'll have to check, be careful here is there are one post-exposure prophylaxis, but with a specific immunoglobulins. You have immunoglobulin for hepatitis B, tetanus and rabies, but we don't have immunoglobulin for HIV. But we have post-exposure prophylaxis with drugs. Echinocandins are a class of antifungal drugs. And recommended first time drug for initial in treatment of TB is isoniazid, rifampicin, ethambutol and pyrazinamide. So echinocandins is The most frequent adverse reaction of significant among people treated with drugs susceptible to TB is hepatitis. We have to do liver function enzymes whenever we start anti-TB treatments. All adult patients in whom anti-TB treatment is being started should undergo baseline assessment of liver function test as I just said. 30-year-old male presents with fever, headache, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, so many symptoms. On examination, tongue is coated, and there is abdominal tenderness, splenomegaly, relative radicali. This is an important thing. And rose spots, they have given the diagnosis. So it's enteric fever. Extrapulmonary sites most commonly involved in TB is all except lymph node, yes, most commonly. Genitourinary TB, yes, we have lots of signs in the KUB films. Skeletal TB, yes, spots, TCs, and etc. Skull TB is the answer. This one of the following is not a clinical feature of botulism. So tetanus is everything being more of spasticity. Botulism is like more of flaccid. So which of the following is not a clinical feature of botulism? Impaired alertness, no. Dysphagia, diplopia, ptosis can occur. Post-exposure prophylaxis for HIV should contain, as I said, three drugs for 28 days. So paralytic rabies. So paralysis means definitely there is no hyperexcitability. Rash also not there. Spastic, no. They have told paralytic. Paralytic means not moving. Not moving is flaccid muscular weakness. All of the following are seen in marasmus itself. Reduced tricep skin fold, yes. Reduced midarm circumference, yes. Protein wasting, no. That's quasi-over. This is marasmus. Decreased BMI, yes. So marasmus won't have protein wasting. Kwashiorkor has protein wasting. A 20-year-old young lady presents with high-grade fever for 5 days and palpable purpura over extremities. She is found to be confused with presence of neck stiffness, that is signifying meningitis. Which of the following is most likely diagnosis? High-grade fever, so there is some infection. So DIC, not likely, acute meningococcal. Yes, antiphospholipid antibody, no, PTP, no. So there is a high-grade fever, so it's probably some kind of infection. And there is also palpable purpura seen in meningococcitis. And neck stiffness suggests meningitis. So fibroblast growth factor 22 is increased in which of the following? Osteomalacia, no. Osteoporosis, no. Paget's disease, no. Renal osteodystrophy, yes. Which of the following crystals are deposited in case of pseudogo? Calcium pyrophosphate dehydrate. Which of the following features are associated with poor prognosis in diffuse cutaneous systemic sclerosis? Old age, yes. High gas transfer factor for carbon monoxide, no. So this is not a sign of poor prognosis actually. Proteinuria, yes. Diffuse skin disease, yes. So 1, 3, 4. Which of the following statements regarding peglotecase are correct? Peglotecase is used in gout. So it's an enzyme conjugate, yes. Useful in chronic gout, yes. Main side effects are infusion reaction and development of antibodies, yes. All are correct. Most common cause of sensory neural hearing loss in adults. So most common is due to old age, that is presbycusis. So due to aging, so the patients develop sensorineural hearing loss. A 50-year-old male presents with dizziness, Which one of the following clinical finding does not favor a central cause? So, which would will not be favorable for a central cause? Probably they're asking which is not related to CNS. So poor saccades, yes, it's due to central cause. Gaze evoked in nystagmus, yes. So when you are turning, there is nystagmus, that is significant central cause. Inhibition by visual fixation. No. So in if there is a when you see something and the nystagmus suddenly stops, so that is probably signifying a peripheral condition. When you see something and the nystagmus doesn't stop, it is a central condition. So answer would be inhibition by visual fixation. So diplopia, dysarthria, yes, obviously it's central cause. A young primi gravida with 11 weeks pregnancy presents with sudden onset pain and swelling in left lower limb. Homan sinus positive, that is Homan sinus dorsiflexion of foot and pain in calf muscles. So duplex ultrasound shows non-compressibility of veins, so it's DVT and absent fluid. So it's some kind of serious thing. Drug of choice for this is enoxaparin, amoxicillin, clavulanic acid, no. Warfarin we can't give in pregnancy. And limb elevation only, no. Because there is a serious problem, only limb elevation will give enoxaparin, which is safe in pregnancy. All of the following are clinical features of hypovolemic shock. Hypovolemic, everything is low. Cold, clammy skin, yes. Bradycardia, no. So when the blood pressure decreases, the heart rate will increase, trying to compensate. So we'll have tachycardia. Hypotension and oliguria, yes. Which of the following is most appropriate to describe classic heat stroke? Heat stroke, usually when there is increase in heat, increase in body temperature, we'll start sweating. So when there is no water left even to sweat, that is the time when heat stroke occurs. So what you'll have to search in the option is, you see, if you see the patient should not have sweating at all. So here in option C, there is increased sweating, so this is not an answer. Option D, increased sweating, this is not an answer. So let's see. Option A, patient temperature above 44 with headache, nausea, loss of consciousness, or above 40 with muscle tremor, confusion, loss of consciousness, and loss of sweating. This should be the answer, loss of sweating. So the following is not a priority in the initial management of shock from a venous snake. Aggressive walling resuscitation, yes. Vasopressor, no. Immediately vasopressors are not needed. We'll need antivenom administration, yes. So the following is not an appropriate criteria for SIRS, systemic inflammatory responsible. Respiratory rate more than 20, yes. Heart rate more than 90, yes. Total count more than 16, total count more than 12 or less than 4. Temperature more than 38, yes. All of the following predispose to acute respiratory distress syndrome, yes. Acute pancreatitis, yes, definitely. Toxic gas, yes. Aspiration of gastric condens, obviously. Severe bronchial asthma. An 8-year-old child has consumed a few tablets of drug that were being taken from his mother on a regular basis. Following this child developed gastric necrosis, acidosis, shock, and hepatic necrosis. What drug could it be? So usually it is an iron tablet. Children require like only 20 mg, but adults usually take 100 mg. So this kid has taken his mother's tablet many times. So probably iron tablet has caused this necrosis. Newborn baby weighing 1.5 kg at birth. So it's like a low birth weight. And at 6 hours of age, lethargy, weak, high pitched cry, difficulty in feeding. What is the next step? Should we check the blood sugar? Should we check calcium? Should we check supplementary oxygen? Or bedside ECG? So usually in low birth weight babies, there is a glycogen stores are not enough. So the sugars are usually low. So we'll check for a blood sugar. In a child with acute organophosphate poisoning, which are found in lactase, anti-cyclogogue, and peripheral parasympatholytic. So carbamate, atropine, benzodiazepine, pralidoxin. So among this, anti-cyclogogue effect is achieved by atropine, and it's also a peripheral parasympatholytic. A 6-year-old child needs to undergo a central catheter placement for TPN. The procedure is likely to evoke pain and anxiety. Which of the following is most appropriate drug for sedation and analgesia in this child? So, chloral hydrate, no. Midazolam, can give sedation, but analgesic effect is not much. Propofol, no. You can give ketamine, yes. It's a good sedative and also a good analgesic given in children. So remember, propofol will decrease the BP, ketamine will increase the BP. Which of the following is the drug of choice in child presenting with supraventricular tachycardia? SVTs, it's always adenosine. So the following drugs used in cardiopulmonary resuscitation for pulseless ventricular fibrillation. So pulseless, atropine, adenosine, lidocaine, and amiodarone. So pulseless ventricular fibrillation is amiodarone. It's like an, as I told earlier, it's like a broad spectrum antiarrhythmic drug. And for resuscitation, in the protocol also, there is amiodarone. Which of the following is sign of good attachment during breastfeeding? Baby's nose is at the level of nipple? No. Baby's chin touches the breast? Yes. Most of the nipple is in mouth and lower areola visible. No, lower areola should not be visible. Baby's lower lip is inverted. No, it should be everted. You know, the following signs is not included as an indicator of a vigorous baby. Immediately after delivery of an infant born through meconium strained ether. So vigorous baby usually will have strong respiratory efforts, good muscle tone, and active movements, but pink color is not an indicator for a vigorous baby. All are true for a cephal hematoma in a newborn. So cephal hematoma versus caput succedaneum, you should have known. Caput succedaneum will cross the suture, cephal hematoma will not cross the suture because it is deep inside. So which is the statement false here? It is located over parietal bones in the subcutaneous plane. No, it is located in deeper, subperiosteal place. So this is wrong. Maybe associated hyperbilirubinemia, yes. The blood will break down and bilirubin can rise. Increase in first day, yes. Can take 6 weeks to resolve, yes. So the following sick neonates can be started on minimal enteral feeding if hemodynamic is stable. Septic neonate with scleroderma. No, can't give. Neonate with necrotizing enterocolitis. No, we should not give because the colon is already necrotizing. Neonate on mechanical ventilation. Yes, we can try because even if on ventilation, we can try nasogastric feeding. Yes. Symptomatic hypoglycemia. No, you please check on this one. So symptomatic hypoglycemia versus neonate on mechanical ventilation. Which one of the following drugs is contraindicated in a mother who is breastfeeding her infant? Obviously, bromocriptine. Bromocriptine will stop the lactation actually. So we could not give bromocriptine. In a term neonate present with tachypnea on day 1 after birth, chest X-ray reveals hyper-expanded lungs, prominent vascular markings, and the important prominent interlobar fissure. So this is usually TTN, transient tachypnea of the newborn. A preschool boy can go upstairs on alternate feet and also start copying a circle. Circle usually kids draw at age 3. How many blocks should he be able to tower with without toppling over? Okay, so 3, remember 3 into 3 is 9. So now the following drugs, antidote for benzodiazepine poisoning, clomazenil. A 3-year-old child develops severe respiratory distress after inhalation of fumes arising from burning plastic. So usually plastic, they release cyanide gases, and the child is started on supporting ventilation. The following needs to be given. Antidote for cyanide is hydroxycobalamin. The child has an incurving of the little finger. Condition is known as camptodactyly. Yes, that is alteration in shape. Brachydactyly, no. Partial cutaneous syndactyly is extra fingers. Clinodactyly is curving of the little finger. Specifically, they have asked for the little finger, so it's clinodactyly. A 4-year-old infant presents with repeated episode of non-bilious vomiting since 7 days. Okay. Infant seems active and hungry after the vomiting. Examination reveals olive-shaped mass in epigastrium. So this is, usually you'll know, it's congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. What is the metabolic abnormality? So this patient will have hypokalemic, hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis with paradoxical aciduria. Which one of the following are correct dose and route of administration of hepatitis B? So we'll give 0.5 ml intramuscularly. You must have gotten your hepatitis B shots. during your rotations, not before your rotations. So it's usually intramuscular. Which of the following statements is correct for approved acellular pertussis vaccine? It contains at least 3 international units of inactivated pertussis toxin. Contains at least 3 pathogenic pertussis antigens. Yes, 3 antigens. Its efficacy is superior to whole cell? No. Presence of non-fimbriel protein? No, it's fimbriel protein. Which of the following is recommended in the follow-up health visits of a child with Down syndrome? Growth assessment twice a year in the first year and annually till 5 years. Annual auditory screening? No. Screening for refractive errors? No. Annual thyroid function? No. So it's growth assessment. A 12-year-old child presents with delayed puberty and delayed bone age. So delayed bone age. His growth records reveal normally till growing normally till 1 year of age, after which both his height and weight fell to below the third centile of age. Subsequently, he continued to grow below the third centile with his normal height velocity, not the most likely diagnosis. Whereas delayed bone age, so it's constitutional growth. According to IMNCI, Integrated Management of Neonatal and Childhood Illness, classification of young infants up to two months, which of the following is not an including possible serious bacterial infection? So fast breathing, 50 or more. No. In less than 2, it's more than 60. 2 to 12 months, it's less than, more than 50. After 12 months, it's more than 40. Which is chest drawing, yes. Axillary temperature, less, yes. Moment only when stimulated, yes. Neonatal tetanus elimination in India's illness, less than 1 case per 1,000 live births. Which of the following facilities has been established at district hospital in India to strengthen the care of low birth weight babies and sick newborns? Which special newborn care units? So, facilities has been established district strengthen the care of low birth weight and sick newborns. Yes, newborns, special newborn care. So with this, we have completed the paper one of last year's UPSC CMS exam. So if you think it's good that we are discussing it together, just comment so that I'll also make a video for the previous year part two of the exam, and we'll solve together again. So that's for today. Thank you.